Here's a look back into yesterday at aviation's leading lady, Miss Amelia Earhart.
She is perhaps the most famous missing person of all time.
The story of a brave woman of the air enters a shroud of mystery.
Amelia Earhart was last heard from in the dawning hours of July 2nd, 1937. She radioed from her beloved Lockheed Electra during her landmark round-the-world flight. Transcripts show her agonizing efforts to reach a Coast Guard ship stationed just off the island in the Pacific where she was scheduled to refuel.
That island was only about a half mile by a mile and a half in the Pacific Ocean.
Margin for error slim to none.
There was no margin for error. They had to be on track.
"We must be on you," Earhart said, "but cannot see you. But gas is running low. Have been unable to reach you by radio."
And the ship that was supposed to be tracking her could hear her. She couldn't hear the ship.
Then at 8:44 a.m., her last known words, uttered with such urgency, "We're running north and south."
Her voice gets increasingly shrill.
And suddenly, silence. 39-year-old Amelia Earhart had vanished.
Miss Amelia Earhart.
Why do you want to fly?
I want to be free.
So 70 years on, why hasn't Amelia Earhart vanished from our imaginations? From children's books to Apple computer ads.
"I'm going to fly around the world."
"It can't be done."
"Well, let's change that."
And now this week's Amelia, starring Hilary Swank. Amelia Earhart has come to embody not tragedy, but gumption and inspiration.
She was living this life the way she wanted to live it, on her own terms, in love, in her career, in following her dreams and following her passions.
Amelia Earhart, to me, is like a comet that shot through the 1930s.
John Norberg writes about aviation.
She was instantly famous. She had the big ticker tape parade in New York.
Back from solo venture from Newfoundland to Iceland, a 2,000-mile ocean hop, she's welcomed home by New York's Jimmy Walker.
She started flying, actually, before parachutes were invented.
Susan Butler, considered one of the world's best experts on Amelia Earhart, says some of that fame stemmed from how dangerous flying was.
Planes were totally untrustworthy. Sometimes an engine would just fall right out of a plane. Everybody called Lindbergh Lucky Lindy because he escaped the fate of most of his friends.
Still, Butler says, Earhart remained undaunted.
She was always very ambitious. What she wanted was an exciting life. And she was looking for thrills, always.
Flying first appeared on Amelia Earhart's radar when the former tomboy was in her early 20s, still unmarried. Her parents were struggling financially and in their relationship. They all moved from Kansas to California, where aviation was taking off.
And once she got in the cockpit, started heading toward the skies, she realized that's what she was destined to do.
Robin Jensen researches and writes about Earhart at Purdue University in Indiana, which houses extensive Earhart archives.
It's June 1928, and crew of airplane Friendship comes ashore at Southampton, England, after flight across the Atlantic.
Jensen says Earhart was plucked from obscurity in 1928 to be the first female passenger on a flight across the Atlantic.
Southampton's woman mayor greets our Lady Lindy.
She looked like the all-American girl. She was essentially picked for the role. She was tall and youthful and excited, and she looked like a movie star.
Striking but not too pretty. Believable,
yeah,
in a heroine role.
She looked like a heroine.
But Earhart didn't feel like a heroine sitting in the back seat of a plane. She wanted to be the one piloting the flights.
Was she selfish? Was she narcissistic?
No, she was a person who demanded to have the adventures that men were having.
She chose a seemingly unlikely path to better her chances of getting what men had. She took a husband, a man of power and wealth, George Palmer Putnam of the publishing Putnams.
But she wrote this letter to him, this prenuptial letter. It sounded like she was being dragged kicking and screaming to the altar.
Right. Earhart was nothing if not invested in her own freedom. She wanted him to know that we'll be married, but this doesn't mean that this is the end in terms of our relationships with other people.
Wow.
Yeah.
And he said yes.
And he said yes. I don't think he blinked an eye. I think he was very invested in marrying Amelia Earhart.
Amelia becomes first woman to fly an autogyro. Married to famed publisher, here helping her into strange craft.
And while it is known that Earhart had at least one lover, Jean Vidal, Gore Vidal's father, it's believed that her husband stayed faithful.
She stayed married, and George Putnam was very much in love with her. In the movie, we really depicted that it was a true love story.
Richard Gere plays George Palmer Putnam opposite Swank's Amelia.
Come back to me. Always.
I think that because she put down on paper what it was that she wanted from the marriage, he kind of allowed her to really be herself.
Bye.
Goodbye.
And almost immediately after their marriage in 1931, Earhart soared into the history books.
She became in 1932 the second person, the first woman, but the second person ever to cross the Atlantic solo.
Here she is, safe and sound on a farm in Ireland, having just completed the first flight by a woman across the Atlantic.
People talk about how good a flyer was she, and how good a thing, how good a navigator was she.
And how good was she?
Had to be pretty good to do that.
How about other records that she broke?
She landed her single-engine Lockheed Vega at Oakland.
She was the first person to fly from Honolulu to California. And her final flight, when she was attempting to fly around the equator, that was the first time a person that attempted to fly at the equator around the world.
For that long final trip, she would need help. Fred Noonan, a well-known navigator, accompanied her, aware of the enormous risks.
She knew that it could be done. She might never come back. But she felt like if she doesn't come back, she'd lived a full life. And she was also concerned about getting old. And this would be an all right way for her legend to find a conclusion.
So aging was one adventure she wasn't ready for.
I think you're right.
Amelia Earhart and her navigator, Fred Noonan, have come to grief in their perilous...
Earhart once said that if she died, she wanted to die in her plane. She said she was only concerned for Noonan, not herself. But Amelia Earhart, both in life and death, eclipsed her navigator and most other aviators of the time.
Why do we remember her? I would argue that it was because she worked very hard on both sides of the fence of promoting herself. The minute she landed, she was writing about what happened that day. She flew, and she wrote, and she talked, repeat, just again and again. And in that sense, she embodies not only the American dream, but the dream that if you work hard, you can accomplish much.
Amelia Earhart wasn't declared legally dead until 2 years after the crash, and there was never a funeral. In every way, she may never be laid to rest.
Our memories of her are that she disappeared. But the real tragedy of Amelia Earhart would be that we would remember her in that way.
Amelia Earhart Putnam prepares to fly the Pacific.
Because her life was dedicated to demonstrating for us that she could go beyond what we expected of her.
She was saying, come on, women, get educated.
And she proves that sometimes, even if your wings get clipped, you still may never fall from grace.
But world will never forget Amelia Earhart.